Okay, please carry on.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. It's my great pleasure to welcome you all to the opening of International Web Conference on Challenges and Opportunity in Chemistry Towards Sustainable Environmental Development, organized by Department of Chemistry, Gaurav Ganguly College, and CSIR, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, Nagpur. First of all, I would like to express my thanks and deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Rakesh Kumar, the Director of CSIR NIRI and Chief Patron, and Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das, the Vice Principal of Gaurav Ganguly College, Patron of this program, for their encouragement and overwhelming support. We are very much grateful to CSIR, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, for their tremendous support and cooperation to organize this web conference, particularly Dr. Rita Dorapkar, the Science Secretary, and Dr. Subdev Pal, the Senior Scientist, for their active engagement in this regard. We are really fortunate to have the support of a great cadre of association from CSIR NIRI. In this entire program, we have 9 eminent speakers from our country and abroad. They exchange their experience and ideas with us. We are very much proud and delighted to have you in this virtual platform. And on behalf of organizing committee, I extend a very warm welcome and sincere gratitude to all of you. Friends, this conference is taking place at a time the COVID-19 outbreak has reinforced the links between health, environment, and the economy, and forward the realization about interconnected nature of the world we live in. Sustainable development must be driven by long-term purpose, actually, that strives to make a positive impact on millions of people, the community, and the environment we share. Hence, the proposed conference entitled Challenges and Opportunity in Chemistry Towards Sustainable Environmental Development may serve as a platform to discuss and learn about new challenges in chemistry and its projected application in environmental application. That should bridge the gap between chemists and environmentalists by or through a brisk exchange of knowledges on noble materials, nanochemistry, and other basic principles involving chemistry, and how this knowledge can be applied to achieve the sustainable environmental development. So, in this light, this conference may provide a forum for international researchers from various areas of chemistry, material science, environmental science, and engineering by providing a platform for critical analysis of new design to share latest cutting-edge research findings and the results about projected environmental application in chemistry. So, I hope you will enjoy today and the following day of deliberation from our speaker. And I certain that it will bear us an useful and very interesting conclusion for the future. So, before coming to a closer, I would like to request my moderators to strictly stick to our time schedule and avoid termination of any session. Thank you very much to all of you. Now I request Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das to deliver the inaugural address. Please, Dr. Das, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Very good morning and welcome to this International Conference on Challenges and Opportunities in Chemistry towards Sustainable Development, Environmental Development, jointly organized by the Department of Chemistry, Gurugram College, and CSIR, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, Nagpur. Let me first express my deep gratitude to Dr. Rakesh Kumar, Director, CSIR Navy, for his positive support and consent that makes this program possible. I also express my gratitude to Dr. Sukhdev Pal, Senior Scientist, CSIR Navy, for his constant support. You know, COVID-19 has severely affected all of us everywhere in the world, in the economy, in the social life. Everything has been changed within a few months. Schools, colleges, universities are closed. And in fact, everyone has to reorganize their thinking about how the days are coming and what steps would be taken to counter the situation. And in fact, we don't know when the situation will be normal, or even if it will be normal, there will be certain changes in every sector of life, in fact, in also higher education. Looking at this scenario, many institutions have stepped forwards and organizing webinar that gives the opportunities to the scholars and in exchanging their views, even in this lockdown period. Various departments of this college, Gurugram College, has already organized a number of webinar, and in fact, Department of Physics of this college has organized the first time in Kolkata an international conference through web, where the speakers delivered their lectures and scholars around the world presenting their papers. That really increases the academic flair. In the same manner, the Department of Chemistry is going to organize this conference, and I express my sincere thanks to Dr. Rajesh Konar, Organizing Secretary, and all his associates for their efforts and dedication that makes things possible. I express my gratitude to the speakers of this conference, staying at different parts of the world. They will enlighten us, they will enrich us. So I express my gratitude to Dr. Rahul Banerjee, FRSC IIACR, Dr. Ramendra Sundar Day, Scientist, Institute of Nanoscience and Technology, Professor Suresh C. Pillai, Scientist, Institute of Technology, Srivo, Ireland, Dr. Rohidas P. Ariute, Seoul National University, Republic of Korea, Dr. Rita Thodkar, and three other senior scientists, Dr. Dipanjan Mujumdar, Dr. Sukhdev Pal, and Dr. Sadhana Ralu. They're the scientists of CSIR NERI. I really thankful to them for their positive consent and sparing their valuable time with us and enrich our participants in their academic endeavors. I'm also thankful to the member of the advisory committee for their constant support. And I express my hearted thanks to Dr. Abul Salam of Sheikh Kudrimundi College for his technical support in arranging this conference possible. And you know that opportunities and threats come side by side. It's true that we are facing certain threats, problems in our daily life, in passing our days strictly around our home. But it also gives us enough time to rethink ourselves, to reorganize our academic efforts. So I do believe that the participants will immensely benefited with this discussion that are to be held on today and tomorrow. So I formally declare the conference open. Thank you all. Stay home, stay safe, enjoy the sessions, enjoy the lectures, enjoy the exchange of views and ideas of the participants. And now I request Dr. Rajesh Kona, the Organizing Secretary, to proceed for the race. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das, for his speech and his very valuable remarks in this regard. Now we are looking for the time for keynote address. I think But unfortunately, what happened due to sudden unavoidable assignment, the keynote address, which was the keynote speech, which was addressed by Dr. Rakesh Kumar, the Honorable Director of CSIR NIRI, cannot possible. But we are fortunate and delighted to have with us Dr. Preeta Dhadapkar, the Science Secretary of CSIR National Environmental Engineering Research Institute. Now, all my friends who are listening this audio and visual conference, let me introduce Dr. Preeta Dhadapkar. I think ma'am is here with us. Dr. Preeta S. Dhadapkar is a Principal Technical Officer and Science Secretary of CSIR NIRI. She has more than 30 years of experience, and her areas of research interest are water and water wastewater management, application of advanced treatment technology, solar and UV photocatalysis, absorption process for water and wastewater treatment, environmental monitoring and remediation of chemicals of emerging concern, and pseudo persistent pollutants, super absorbent polymer for environmental remediation. She has worked in industry sponsored research and consultancy projects for wastewater management related problems in sewage treatment plants, refineries, paper industries, metal and minerals, coke oven and steel, distilleries, textile, tanneries, etc. for the last 20 years. She is a recipient of a number of national and international collaborative projects like Royal Society of UK, Global Challenges Research Fund, Research Council of UK, CMI PDB Germany, etc. and was awarded the Commonwealth Science Council Training Fellowship, Honorary Diploma SEC Environmental Award for Excellence in Research in Waste Valorization at the second International Conference on Engineering for Waste Valorization, which was held at Patras, Greece. She served as an external advisory board member to EU Horizon 2020 project on water spout. She has more than 40 original research publications in high impact journals of national and international repute, and has also authored 2 Indian patent applications and 3 design registration applications. So now, may I request Dr. Dhadapkar to deliver the keynote address. Over to you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you for your kind words of introduction. And and thank you, Bhairab Ganguly College, for organizing this wonderful webinar on challenges and opportunities in chemistry towards sustainable future. I thank Dr. Sanjeev Das and Dr. Conner for giving me this time on the keynote address. And very shortly, I will just start my presentation, and somebody will help me from here. So I will be talking on an overview of our institute and the history behind it, how we have grown from 1958, our work areas, and the technologies of CSIR NIRI. I have been recently appointed the Science Secretary, and it's a great pleasure to be here in this webinar. I can see there are a lot of students. CSIR NIRI encourages students to join NIRI as project staff, as research fellows, people who are interested in work on environment. And for this aspect, I will be sharing the work done by NIRI and the students can benefit by learning what technologies NIRI is working on, what are our research areas, and how we work here in the CSIR system. As you know, CSIR is a Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. There are 38 laboratories, national laboratories under this system. National Environmental Engineering Research Institute is placed at Nagpur. It was established in 1948 due to a very, epidemic of jaundice and in that year, it was known as the Central Public Health Engineering Research Institute. It was renamed in 1974 when Indira Gandhi visited for the 62nd governing body meeting on 2nd May. And then it was named as the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute with an initial mandate of water and sanitation. Currently, we deal with all the aspects of environmental science and engineering, including climate change. NIRI supports and acts as regional centers for many international conventions and treaties on environmental issues. So what is NIRI's vision? Is leadership in environmental science and energy engineering for sustainable development. What is its mission? It will continue to strive for providing innovative and effective solutions for environmentally sustainable development and help the government, industry, and society, and the so many million people who are unprivileged in India. So what is our journey and what were our objectives right from 1958 to 2018? So in 1958, we started with water and wastewater treatment, potable water disinfection, public health engineering, and removal of heavy metals. Later in 1968, you can see we started air monitoring, development of sampling devices, waste disposal, industrial wastewater treatment, international work networking, and Nalgonda technique. I'll be talking about a little bit about Nalgonda technique. This is a technique for the removal of fluorides from drinking water. In 1978, we moved on to solid waste management, epidemiological studies, fugitive emissions monitoring, resource recovery-based water treatment system designs, and environmental materials. In 1988, we had started with environmental impact and risk assessment, hazardous waste management, catalytic converter for vehicles, cleaner technologies, and systems modeling. In 1998, we carried on with we had achieved carrying capacity-based studies for larger project areas and planning, river rejuvenation, genotoxicity and health, indoor air pollution, groundwater studies, phytoremediation, waste-to-energy, remote sensing, and GIS source apportionment studies. By 2008, we shifted to clean energy, chemo bioremediation, biomitigation, frugal and need-based technologies and environmental solutions for society, voice monitoring, waste-to-value, and skill development. By 2018, we are into strategic urban planning, environmental damage, cost assessment, big data analysis, in-situ nala treatment, chemical sustainability, technology incubation, and entrepreneurship development. Now we see what is the R&D focus in 2020, where we are. We have wastewater treatment, we have clean air, climate change, environmental system designs and modeling, environmental biotechnology, environmental materials, environmental impact and risk assessment, environmental damage analysis and cost assessment, environmental health, environmental genomics, solid and hazardous waste management, and clean water. How we achieve our work? What is our staff strength? We are 292 staff in NIRI. We have a group 4 which consists of scientists. We have 104 scientists, We have technical supporting staff, which are 35 in number, other supporting staff, which is 52, and a strong administration of 101. So we work in project mode, we have technologies, we publish papers, we have MOU with government, private industries, academics, and NGOs. We have patents filed in international and national, and we have scientist students connect, we have skill development, we have design registrations for our technologies and new designs in environmental engineering. We have outreach and training program, which have benefited over 10 lakhs of citizens of India. We have training programs, workshops, seminars, and we have training designed for industrial purpose, industrial staff. So what is our pan-India presence? As you can see, these orange dots are, this is our headquarters in Nagpur, where I'm talking from right now. We have zonal centers in Delhi, Mumbai, Calcutta, Hyderabad, and Chennai. For the last 5 years, we have worked with state and municipal agencies, central public health, public sector agencies, state public sectors, private sector industries, foreign collaboration, central government agencies, and a lot of NGT cases which are coming to us. We also contribute to India's national mission for Namami Gange. You must be all aware of this. We have worked in special properties of River Ganga. We have monitored the river quality right from Devprayag to the Diamond Harbor. The river rejuvenation we have carried out through natural treatment systems for the Namami Gange in Swachh Bharat. We have the electrolytic defluoridation, iron removal plants, phytorid, natural water treatment technologies, rapid composting, menstrual waste management technologies. For Swasth Bharat, we have worked on phytorid for sewage treatment, air pollution control and health benefits, solar water disinfection, electrolytic defluoridation, iron removal plants, chemo defluoridation, improved multi-fuel cook stove. In smart city, you know, this recently launched program, we work for water safety plans, lake restoration, wastewater recycle reuse, plantation for degraded lands. We are also working in the National Green Highway Mission, and we have strategically designed green belt development along the highway. We have a large international partnership with NIRI, and there are almost 32 countries which work in close association with us through collaboration, and this is constantly growing. If we come to one of the international important international collaboration that we have, it is the Stockholm Conventional Regional Center for Asia, which is NIRI is the nodal agency. We are endorsed as the regional center for capacity building and technology transfer at COP5 meeting during 2011 at Geneva. What is the objectives? It is the capacity building activities, monitoring and assessment of persistent organic pollutants in various environmental matrices, research activities for the societal benefit. We have an international workshop on management of POPs in India, need and gap analysis in 2019. Our development of national implementation plan is in the measures in relation to unintentionally produced POPs and measures in relation to waste and contaminated sites. Activities supported by Secretariat of Basel Rotterdam and Stockholm Convention is capacity building for promoting synergistic implementation of Basel Rotterdam and Stockholm Convention in Sri Lanka. Pilot testing of guidance for the review and update of National Implementation Plan in India. Electronic interactive tool for environmentally sound management of industry chemicals. Capacity building for ESM of PCB oil and PCBs containing equipments at shipbreaking yard, Alang, Gujarat. And what is our ongoing R&D activity? We are developing methodology for analysis of PVDEs in different environmental matrices and also evaluating its toxicity. But we come to the journey of CSIR NEERI, and from 1958, as I had said earlier, to 1974, we were seafaring and we focused mainly on water and wastewater. We had technical cooperation mission with USA for training young scientists in public health engineering. We were WHO nomination for community water supply and waste disposal. We were nominated by WHO as the collaborating institute in community water supply and waste disposal. Transfer of know-how on refluoridation of water to Tanzania. Multi-gas sampling kit for simultaneously four or more gases. We were the WHO regional reference on air pollution for 5 years. National air sampling network to formulate emission standards under Indian condition. 1975 to 1986, our focus shifted to technologies and solutions, including rural sanitation, oxidation lagoons, slow sand filtration, Nalgonda technique for defluoridation, biological discs, disinfection tablets, and automatic samplers. Air quality monitoring started from Kolkata and Taj Mahal Trapezium during 1975-1976. Utilization of pulp mill effluent for irrigation. This is one of the hazardous waste effluents which come out from paper and pulp mill and very difficult to treat. So HRTS system was established during these years. Development of rapid method for detection and enumeration of fecal coliforms in wastewater. Treatment and disposal of wastewater from fertilizer industry, input and stack emissions from selected industries on neighborhood air quality, development of instruments for environmental monitoring. So we did pioneering studies during 1987 to 2000 in EIRA, that is Environmental Impact and Risk Assessment, Carrying Capacity, Life Cycle Assessment, EIA of Antarctica. Industrial and field demonstration of technologies, including common effluent treatment plants, catalytic converter, mine dump and restoration. Advanced instruments like smoke meter, high volume sampler, water quality monitoring kit, arsenic detection kit. National ambient air quality monitoring activities, which we still carry on. Landmark SC judgment on track, Taj Trapezium, based on our NEERI report earlier. Audit of global environmental monitoring stations in South Asian countries. Development of framework of World Bank and Ministry of Environment Forest Assisted Network of Clean Technologies for Industrial Production. From 2001 to 2011, we took up planned projects undertaken on industrial waste minimization in other areas. Environmental technologies like electro-defluoridation, phytoxid, iron removal, NEERI, ZHAR. This was developed for flood, where the floods were for drinking water, immediate solution for drinking water, the HRTS high rate transpiration system, the hazardous waste disposal, CETPs for leather industries, we also took up international projects with USEPA, EU, GICA, WHO, and UNICEF. US EPA and NEERI collaborated on joint drinking water laboratory strengthening work and preparation of guidance manual. Technical strengthening of PHED and UNICEF for UNICEF Bhopal, NEERI collaboration of effective delivery of TSC and SD. So if we come to the present, what we are working on is clean energy generation through chemical looping combustion, geospatial web application for zone and site selection of groundwater recharge, land rejuvenation through microbe-assisted green technology, pollution abatement technologies for river rejuvenation, nano intermetallic alloy catalyst as promising alternatives to expensive pattern catalysts for fuel cells, noise mapping and mitigation strategies for major cities in India, design and development of enhanced natural attenuation for in situ nala treatment. When we say in situ, means through the nala only we design the wastewater treatment, which is a non-point source of pollution to the rivers. Development of reduced emission of firecrackers. We have transferred the technology to many crackers making industries. Environmental damage cost assessment and ecosystem services evaluation for strategic urban management was introduced in the last 3 years. So if we come to the study of special properties of River Ganga, which we did, this I wanted to have a separate slide for it, because this study was carried out for the National Mission of Clean Ganga, and we saw that very high dissolved oxygen is present throughout in Ganga, and the phytoplanktons were responsible for the high dissolved oxygen. More number of bacteriophages against pathogenic bacteria were found, and the bacterial count was static or it decreased. So the studies are still going on into the antimicrobial properties of Ganga water, the phytochemicals from medicinal plants which have been detected in Ganga water. Other important projects, we have done water quality for Maldives, we have done geophysical methods for monitoring bioremediation, we have introduced and implemented water safety plans, and such first time it was demonstrated for Amravati study under the 12th plan project. We do a lot of work for CSR 800, which is our projects on projects for society, and under this sustainable solutions for energy and environmental challenges in rural area, we have demonstrated Meri Dhur, which is an improved crop adoption, and information education and communication studies, and we have studied its impact assessment on the people who use this cook stove. We have demonstrated and developed and demonstrated low cost fuel from agriculture waste. We have field demonstrated, carried out user perception studies on domestic water defluoridation techniques, low cost and affordable technologies for improving the sanitation and hygiene in rural areas, developing of bamboo diversity on degraded waste and barren land, even on fly ash waste. We have developed bamboo and demonstrated in several lands near Nagpur and Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh. Developing of rapid composting technologies in selected villages, mass scale spirulina protein production and food supplementation for common men at Pachgaon, Nagpur. So these are our few milestones, I would say, which have directly contributed to the society. Now we come to another problematic, environmentally problematic area, which is the disposal of about the sanitary pads, which, and you can see the number, it's about more than 600 million pads are disposed. With enhanced awareness and availability of low-cost pads, this volume will increase manifolds. So what are the current disposal practices? It is thrown in routine dustbins, thrown away in open, burning or burying in toilets, flushing down. So what is the challenge with traditional incinerators? It is burning at low temperatures, not exceeding 300 and 500. Do not adhere to incinerator standards for emission by CPCB, and no control for toxic emissions. So NIRI has developed this green dispo, which is a patented product. Its capacity is 30 to 40 pads per hour, and it can be scaled up to community scale. Its energy cost is only 25 paisa per pad. The advantages with green dispo is it is an energy efficient design, adhere to incinerator standards if temperatures exceed 800 degrees, post-combustion heater exceeds 1,000 to control toxic emissions. And we have already, by CPCB and this MWWS has identified this electrical incineration and as safe and recommended for the use of sanitary pads. I will just skip this. Now we come to Phytovit, the domestic wastewater treatment. This has been applied in over 60 installations all over India. It's a re-engineered advanced wetland technology. It's negligible maintenance cost. It's a natural wetland wastewater treatment system. This system looks like a landscape and gardens. It complies with the regulations laid down by CPCB and SPCBs, and it's qualified for green rating credits by IGBC under water efficiencies. It allows reuse of grey water up to 95%. This is a patented technology, and the POD reduction which is achieved is due to the O2 diffusion in liquid, which is a limiting factor in any sewage treatment plant, no matter how it is supplied. So what is the advantage? It has improved surface area, which helps in mass transfer of the oxygen to the newest. So how does it work? It's a biochemical oxidation of organics, nitrification, denitrification, phosphate uptake by the special plants, and the anaerobic treatment zones, which are at the bottom. I will skip this, but just to inform you that we have installed electrolytic defluoration plants in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh states with the financial support of Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. And nearly 200 electrodefluoration plants have been installed, and more details are available with Navy. This we got a lot of publicity for the fantastic work done on improved fire packers for reduced emissions, and Dr. Sadhana Rayalu will be talking on this later in your workshops, in your webinar, so I will also skip this. Now, WIU is a device which is jointly done by NIRI and IIT Bombay. It is an air quality at traffic intersections is worse as vehicles typically undergo long idling, acceleration, and deceleration there. So this device helps to clean air and also generates turbulence to increase dispersion of pollutants. And two major principles is the active pollutants control by the filter, which is kept in the this device, and the wind augmentation for dilution of pollutants. So it removes VOCs, PM10, PM2.5. Its efficiency is almost 60 to 70% in the particulate matter reduction and 50 to 60% in VOC reduction. So the UV tubes are also there, so its basic component is filtration and photocatalytic oxidation. This is a restoration of Nalaf with ecological units, which we have already demonstrated in 6 drains in Prayagraj, which were polluting the river Ganga. During Kumbh, NIRI undertook this task of installing this renew system in the Nala. And as you can see, this is the Nala before and after cleaning and after installation of our renew technology. The thing is that this technology, you do not need additional space. Its units are designed such that in situ the wastewater is treated, and you can see the treated wastewater, how clean it is. So this was when we had, after installation, Nitin Gadkari ji has tweeted, and he had given us a lot of encouragement in this, and this is how our new looks at need looks like at NIRI. This is a work which I had done for solar disinfection of water. This is a compound parabolic design which is called Swadhi CPC. It is a device for rural community, urban areas inhabited by rural population or slums, and it provides bacteriologically safe water. How does it work? It works by the synergistic effect of exposure of UV rays of sunlight and heat produced due to radiation of immobilized nanoparticles, which converts light to energy, and it gives a temperature of almost 55 degrees centigrade. So this technology is available with NIRI. We have already demonstrated in Udaipur and Mumbai slums, and we got a very good user perception study done, and and it is available for any study, anyone to take up. So my second part of the presentation is on photo irradiation and adsorption based novel innovations for water treatment. This is called Pani Water. It is a project which I am coordinating from India, and Sukhdev Pal and Dr. Nishant Dafre are my partners from NIRI in this. As you can see, we have 6 partners and about 12 EU partners, and it's a very big project of 4 years with a 4.9 million budget. What we are doing in this is we are developing and deploying and validating 6 prototype technologies for the removal of contaminants of emerging concern from water and wastewater. We are going to demonstrate this in several sites across India. Now, if you come to STPs and the problems and issues, the basis of estimation of sewage quantity is the water supply. The quantity of water supplied, 80% of that we assume is the wastewater. What is the challenge in STPs? The economic characteristics, the cost of treatment technology, and the land availability, especially in the urban areas and the metro cities. The treatment technologies versus discharge standards. As you know, sewage is treated in sewage treatment plant, and discharge standards are laid down by Ministry of Environment and Forests, and CPCB guidelines are there, and these treated effluent have to meet these discharge standards. So we have very old plants which need renovation, and the secondary treatment is almost never followed by tertiary treatment, which may be just chlorination or physical chemical treatment or any other form of disinfection. Sewage is often mixed with industrial water. This is especially true for metro cities. And stricter norms are there for outlet, as you know that there are NGT orders last year, and the norms for discharge have become stricter, but there are no norms for inlet parameters, and we often have shock loads in the STP as industrial water is mixed. Incentive and resource earning, this is one thing we have to work on if we have to have these sewage treatment plants, have a success in this, because unless we have the wastewater treated to that level that it meets the regulations for irrigation or any other reuse, this STP wastewater is just discharged into the river otherwise. It's decentralized versus centralized. Centralized, you know, it is placed in one place, and decentralized, now you can have in small townships. Nalas are non-point sources of pollution and uncounted sewage, and this can serve as a water source, often serves as a water source for farmers, and that is what I was talking about, is resource earning and incentive. Future problems are there are no phosphorus solutions, the contaminants of emerging concern, the antibiotic resistant bacteria and chains. What are these contaminants of emerging concern? These are chemicals and other substances which have no regulatory standard. They are recently discovered in natural streams. Why I put discovered is they were always there, but because of the better analytical facilities, we have discovered them. And often because of improved analytical chemistry detection levels, we are able to detect up to nanogram levels. They can potentially cause deleterious effects in aquatic life and environmentally relevant concentration. They are pollutants which are not included in routine monitoring programs and may be candidates for future regulation, depending on their ecotoxicity, potential health effects, public perception, and frequency of occurrence in environmental media. So you can see how much study remains to be done. There are other persistent organic pollutants which are a part of these contaminants of emerging concern. There are pharmaceuticals and personal care products. There are veterinary medicines. There are endocrine disrupting chemicals, and there are nanomaterials. So what is this cycle? These pharmaceuticals, and if we see only pharmaceutical and personal care product cycle, we consume them, it is consumed by animals, by human beings. This is going into the STP in form of liquid. From the animals, we get these biosolids and the all the medicines are not being used by the animals and humans. All the quantity is not being used, and the residual medicines are flushed out into the STP. Now, STP treated water, as we talked earlier, serves as a source for the agricultural farmers. And these biosolids are also used as manure. And you see, this is a cycle. And where does this accumulate? It may accumulate in the food produce that we are eating. So why we should worry is that these active ingredients and personal care products are designed to simulate a physiological response in humans, plants, and animals. EDCs are chemicals that interact with our HPG axis. Example, bisphenol, EE2, ethyl estradiol, antibiotic residues which are responsible for the antibiotic resistant bacteria and genes, the biomic accumulation in food produce, the risks to our health is uncertain. Aquatic toxic profile needs to be determined and persistence is of concern. If we see the different classes of CEC, you can see the pharmaceutical, the steroids and hormones, the personal care products and others, and in the others, the caffeine and bisphenol is there, which is an endocrine disrupting agent. And the antibiotics and the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, the beta blockers, and so on and so forth. Now, these are laid in the contaminant candidate list of EPA. And future regulation is likely to happen in under the Safe Drinking Water Act. So if we come to determination of CECs, what is the challenge? Is that a very large quantity of sample is required. You have to develop analytical methodology, lengthy procedures, sophisticated instruments, sample preparation techniques, and recovery of the CECs is very important from the sample. The standards are very expensive and they expire in 1 year. There are a large number of components, as you saw in the earlier slide, there are almost 219 components, and they are also polar compounds. So if you come to sample cleanup and analytical methodology, there is a sample which is centrifuged, then it is filtered, then it is gone through us. Solid phase extraction and followed by HPLC. It can be detector, can be PDA, it can be RF, or it can be MS. So this nearly takes about, you know, more than 15 to 20 days for one sample to be processed. Tracking of indicator bacterial and antibiotic resistant burden in sewage treatment plant is another thing which is also very expensive. And isolation of antibiotic resistant bacteria and genes can be done by cultural approach and molecular approach. We have the metagenomic DNA isolation, or it can be detected in different media with specific antibiotics. This is very expensive but very reliable, and it minimizes the time. But this is a time-taking technique. So, okay. So if you see, I will just give you one very short example, very quickly one example of one STP in Delhi, is that you see the STPs which are old are near the new STP, and all the discharge is coming commonly, and it goes through a canal which, and there is agriculture field beside it. So if you see the inlet of this one STP, it is 260 milligrams per liter chemical oxygen demand, and the outlet is very good. You see the chemical oxygen demand, it is 30. But this is a new STP, and what happens when it comes to the main outlet, it is mixing with the outlet of the two old STPs, and the COD becomes 90 milligrams per liter. Now this situation is a common situation in India, and you can see the combined outlet has very high organics and high nitrogen and phosphorus. Farmers are very happy because they think that they have fertilizer in, they can use this treated wastewater, and it has a large amount of organics and nitrogen and phosphorus which can be used in the for the agriculture. But they are unaware of the contaminants of an emerging concern, the antibiotic resistant bacteria and genes. And you can see what is the neighboring huge amount of agricultural land which is adjacent to all STPs. What we have found in this project is that these many compounds are present in almost all the CTPs we are monitored. In spite of chlorination, the coliform count is very high. We have a very high concentration of antibiotic resistant bacteria. The genes I have not given, there's a huge table of the antibiotic resistant genes which are found. What we are doing under this project is a tertiary treatment technology for demonstration in pilot scale, and this is the Pani Water project plan. Proposed tertiary treatment, we have a dual step multifunctional reactor. We are going to combine physicochemical and advanced oxidation process. It is almost the first time that such a process will be demonstrated in India. We will be using ozone, which will be treated in conjunction with UVC and or hydrogen peroxide. Our second technology is on solar photolytic plant, and it is a tertiary level treatment. Again, we'll be using solar and UV along with the advanced oxidation process. Here we will be utilizing hydrogen peroxide or persulfate process. And the third system is a photoelectrochemical system, which will be solar driven, hence high irradiated surface pilot reactor with large area irradiated photo anode will be used. Thank you. I think I have exceeded my time.
Thank you.
I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your enthusiastic remarks about the sustainability of our environment. This kind of deliberation actually enrich us, not only academically, but it has socio-economic impact as well. However, the real impact that our students have got, they are motivated for the future purpose. Thank you, madam. Thank you very much for sharing your very valuable time with us. Thank you very much, ma'am. Looking for your further association in near future. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you. Now, I welcome Professor Banerjee. Just excuse us for a couple of minutes. The vote of thanks event is pending. It takes only 3 to 5 minutes. Please excuse us. So now I request Dr. Shubhendu Dhara, the assistant professor of Department of Chemistry, Guru Ganguly College, to deliver the keynote address very shortly. So over to you, Dr. Dhara.
Am I audible to everyone?
Yes.
Respected Vice Principal Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Das, Bhairav Ganguly College, and Honorable Director Dr. R. Kumar Niri, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, and respected Science Secretary Dr. Rita S. Dhrapkar, CSI Niri, and our most valued speakers for the all sessions for this today's webinar. Particularly for today's session, Professor Rahul Banerjee, Professor, Department of Chemical Science, Isar, Kolkata, who is a recipient of prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2018 for his contribution to the science, and Dr. Ramendra Sundar De, Scientist C, Institute of Nanoscience and Technology, Mohali, and Professor Suresh C. Pillai is a leading scientist from IIT Sligo, Ireland. My dear colleagues and dear participants, a very good morning and a warm welcome to this 2 days International Web Conference entitled as Challenges, Opportunities in Chemistry and Sustainable Environmental Development, jointly organized by Department of Chemistry, Bhairav Ganguly College and CSIR Niri, Nagpur. Under this pandemic situation, it is very high time to gather in this type of web conference to share our views and opinions. I am Dr. Shubhendu Dhara, convener of this web conference, on behalf of this entire organizing committee, jointly by Bhairav Ganguly College and Niri Nagpur. Let me call it a fraternity of chemistry and environmental science here together, and on my own behalf, extend my hearty thanks to all the dignitaries for their gracious presence and willingness to come forward to make this event happen. Hope this event will be a great success, and coming sessions of all the today's web conference will be beneficial to all the participants for their future endeavor. And thank you all for your participation once again. And without taking it further, I am giving the screen to Dr. Rajesh Konar. To start the coordination the first technical session of this web conference. Over to you, Dr. Konar. Hello.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dhara.
Over to you, Dr.
For your remarks. Now the inaugural session is over. And we immediately switch to our technical session one. Our research person is already here with us. So, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please, in the technical session one. The first speaker of this session is Professor Rahul Banerjee. It's my immense pleasure to introduce Professor Rahul Banerjee, the Associate Professor of Department of Chemical Science, Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Kolkata. Dr. Banerjee graduated in chemistry from University of Calcutta in 1998 and master's from Rajabaja Science College, University of Calcutta in 2000. His doctoral studies were at University of Hyderabad under the guidance of TWAS laureate Professor Gautam Radhakrishnan Desiraju. And he received his PhD in crystal engineering and supramolecular chemistry in the year of 2006. Now he moved to US to do his postdoctoral work in the laboratory of Omar M. Yagi at the University of California, Los Angeles. And on his return to India, he in 2008, he joined the National Chemical Laboratory Pune as a scientist C. He moved to the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Kolkata, in 2017. He has received so many academic awards for his outstanding research and findings. During his days at University of California, Los Angeles, in 2008, Dr. Banerjee received two honors, the Postdoctoral Recognition Award and the Amgen Postdoctoral Award, both awarded by the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry, University of California. The Indian Academy of Sciences selected him as a Young Associate in 2009, and he received two Young Scientist Awards in 2011, the NASHI Young Scientist Platinum Jubilee Award and the CSIR Young Scientist Award. Dr. Banerjee received the most prestigious fellowship of Royal Society of Chemistry, The National Academy of Sciences, India and elsewhere honored again in 2014 with the NASHI Scopus Young Scientist Award. And 1 year later, he received the Thomson Reuters Research Excellence India Citation Award. In the same year, he received the 2015 B.M. Birla Science Prize in Chemistry, and he was selected for the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship of the Department of Science and Technology in 2016. The Council of Scientific and Industrial Research awarded him the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, one of the highest Indian science award in 2018, for his remarkable contribution to chemical sciences. The main objective of his research on designing metal organic framework for improved gas uptake property, particularly hydrogen storage and carbon capture. He has published more than 150 research articles of international report with high impact. He has participated in several scientific events, including the Royal Society of Chemistry Roadshow 2017, held at National Chemical Laboratory, Pune, where he was one of the keynote speakers. He is also an associate editor of Crystal Engineering Communication, a journal of Royal Society of Chemistry. But last but not the least, he is an outstanding personality, particularly in the field of structural chemistry and supramolecular chemistry. Obviously, we are delighted to have Dr. Banerjee with us in this session, and he will deliver on the porous framework material, what are they good for. So welcome, Professor Rahul Banerjee. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Kunaj, and very good morning to all of you. It's indeed an honor and a pleasure for me to give this deliver this talk on in this webinar platform. To be very honest, I prefer, and I think I guess we prefer. Prefer to deliver physical lectures rather than webinar. I am audible, I guess, right?
Yes, sir. Very clear.
Yeah, you are audible. All right. Fine. Thank you. So yeah. So as I was, what I was telling is, I think we all prefer physical meetings. And to be very honest, I prefer physical meetings rather than webinar, because in webinar, it is hard for you to do an interaction after the meeting. But that being said, the current scenario is not like that. And we have to, you know, understand and respect the scenario and, you know, try to do whatever and try to extract the most out of it. So on that note, I thank the organizers for this conference, for their kind invitation, and the organization as well. It is indeed a great honor and great pleasure that I got this opportunity, and they have thought about my name. Okay, so without further delay, let us discuss what we are planning to discuss today, which is porous materials. And the most of the important topic of the discussion is, what are they really good for? I mean, are they really good for anything, to be very honest? So let us see, let us think a little bit carefully. And if we look around, we will see that we are actually surrounded by porous materials. What do I mean by that? I mean, you know, think about the bread, cake, and, you know, all the, you know, the shirt, pant, all these things, aqua guard, your water filter, everything is a porous material. You know, the, you are using porous material day in and day out in your Surf Excel. So these porous materials, we are to be very honest, surrounded by. Now, surrounded by means what? I know, because we cannot live without them. So this is a main aspect of the porous material science. And not only that, in the current scenario, if you think, in the current scenario in the last few months, if you see that we are even more sort of covered by the porous material. Why do I say that? You know, these face masks, what we are using, if you just take it to a simple, you know, undergraduate laboratory, you don't need to go to a fancy laboratory or something. And if you put these face masks under microscope, you will see that it is a very nice porous structure like whatever I have presented here. You know, it's very simple. You know, you just take a simple microscope and you will see it. Even if you just lift this particular mask and in front of the sun, and you will see this kind of nice porous pattern. So porous materials are important. They are sort of, it's like water. You know, we cannot live now without these porous materials. So that brings me to today's lecture, where we want to have a structured porous material. That means like this, you know, see, you have seen these bamboo sticks lying in the roadside and whatever. They mean nothing. But if you take those same bamboo sticks and assemble and tie them in a proper order, you can make these beautiful pandals in which we will have our Durga Puja about 100 days from now. So you can imagine, I don't know whether we will be able to celebrate it, because it's a big celebration for all Bengalis. We look forward to these 4 days. I mean, and I don't know this year what is going to happen. I hope for the best. So these porous materials, so this is exactly like a porous structure that we make using those bamboo sticks, which otherwise means nothing. So similarly, in the molecular chemistry or the framework material, you can also do such thing and construct this kind of beautiful architecture, porous architectures. How? That is the question. How do you do that? So those who are from the chemistry background know that, you know, basic zinc acetate structure is like this. This is what I'm trying to show you. So this is basic zinc acetate structure. Those who are not from physics background, so for them, I just want to say that you just don't worry about the all technical nitty-gritties here. Just see that this overall zinc acetate, if you crystallize or if you get the molecular structure, they form this kind of nice cluster, which can be presented sort of like in this way, you know, like this particular way. Now, if you think that this is a joint, and if we connect this joint via some kind of, let's say, organic strut, like what? So this was the joint and connected to another joint via some kind of organic strut. So then we can create a porous structure, like exactly what we have shown, the pic, I mean, like what exactly you have designed. So it is like this. The beauty of these materials that I'm about to tell you is that these materials, you know, you can think about these materials in the laboratory, and you can go to the laboratory or go to the bench, and then you can make those materials like what you have thought. It is so challenging for other fields to think about a material precisely what you want to make and go to the laboratory or the bench to make it. It's like simple, like organic chemistry, that I want to make this compound, I do retrosynthesis, I find out, okay, these will be my ingredients, and from there, building from those building blocks, I eventually make the final, you know, large organic molecule for drug, API, and, you know, and other purposes. So look at this, that, you know, final synthesis of it. Simple terephthalic acid. What is a terephthalic acid? Once again, those who are not from chemistry background, terephthalic acid is the monomeric ingredient of those PET bottles, that water bottles that you are using at your house. So those are polymer, and I am talking about the monomer. You know, so polymer means polymer, poly unit, you know, mar means unit. So similarly, the monomer. So that is terephthalic acid. If you take terephthalic acid, which is nothing but benzene dicarboxylic acid like this, If you react it with zinc nitrate, and then you will get these beautiful crystals of zinc terephthalate. They look like exactly like this box. This is the crystal structure. And you can see over here, there is a joint. You connect this joint to another joint and so on and so forth. And you create this nice cubic architecture where the yellow balls represents the openness of the structure. So this is basically the construction of these materials. It's very simply nomenclatured. What is that simple nomenclature? They are made from metal like zinc. Okay, they have organic unit. Yes, so metal organic. They create a framework, so metal organic. So it's very simple nomenclature, no artificial jargons. So then comes to the point, then of course people will ask, you know, see, we are surrounded by porous materials, like you said already, you know, you showed all this cake and whatnot. And I must tell you that I know them very well, because although I could not make any cake during this lockdown period, but I have become a sort of, you know, expert. I mean, you know, I give that certificate to myself, that I have sort of become an expert of making bread, you know, from the scratch. Now, if you come to ISAR, at least even I can't do anything, I can't show you any science, but I will be more than capable to make a bread, Indian roti, for you, and which I'm sure probably you will like it. So anyway, so that sort of, you know, my expertise. So now if we are surrounded by those porous materials, question is, why on earth we should make a new one? I mean, who cares? What is the point? I mean, these are the questions that we should ask before we get into a research project. So then people thought that, okay, all right, that's a very important question. So what are these porous materials good for? So the porous materials, so initially we figured out that these materials could be good for hydrogen storage. Hydrogen, first topic of the lecture, a big, type of stuff. So I'll make it. So hydrogen storage, what is that? So the logic was, I'll tell you a quote, sort of unquote, but a theme that Ratan Tata told many, many years ago, I mean, probably 2-3 years ago, if not more, that he told that before I'm known in this world, I'd like to see all cars in the world, especially in India, are driven by water. Water, that's a very comment. So you may think that, are you crazy? You know, that's what you have to be, you know, something. You have to be a little bit crazy. So what is the science behind it? So initially I also thought like that. But when I looked into the literature carefully and I figured out that if you take water, if you split it into hydrogen and oxygen, which is called water splitting, which is a very well-known feature, you can Google it and you can find out more about it. So then that take that hydrogen and oxygen, which you have splitted, you bring it to a fuel cell and then you recombine those and you get water again and you get electron. You get the electron, you use the electron to run the car or, you know, power up your house or whatever, and you get the water back, you split it and you keep on doing it. Beautiful science, you know, unbelievable, but it's so difficult to do it. I'll totally show you one problem and you will understand how challenging this whole process is. And that should be, in my opinion, should be the future of modern science. So what is the problem? Problem is this hydrogen storing, and you want to store hydrogen after splitting water and you want to push it to your car, right? So from Mohanpur to, let's say, Belgodia or, you know, let's say Dunlop, it's roughly around 70 kilometers. So if I have to go there and come back, it's about 150 kilometers. So in order to drive a car which will do this job, I need around 1 kilogram of hydrogen. 1 kilogram of hydrogen. Okay, because you need hydrogen to combine with oxygen to get the water. Even if you can't split water, let's forget about it. If we don't know the science, let's forget about it. We store hydrogen into a cylinder and we run our vehicle and we go to Bhairav Ganguly College and come back. So 150 kilometers roughly, give and take. So I need 1 kg of hydrogen, and to store 1 kg of hydrogen, I need one balloon of 1 meter diameter stuck in my car. I mean, you can imagine 1 meter, just measure how many foot it is. And, you know, 1 meter diameter balloon. I mean, you know, your car will be covered with the balloon. So you can imagine. So that's not feasible. We have no space. Already we are run out of space. So we can't fit one balloon next to a car. So we need to compress that hydrogen into a closed environment or in a smaller environment. How do we do that? We already do that. We use cooking gas as gas, like LPG. We switch on the bulb, we use it and we burn it. But we don't store it like gas. We store it like liquid, right? So similarly, we can also store hydrogen like liquid. Yes, we can. Of course we can. Why can't we? So it follows the same phenomena. But if you want to do something like that, you have to give tremendous amount of pressure, because hydrogen is the lightest element in the periodic table, the first element of the periodic table. So you have to give a tremendous pressure to bring all the hydrogen molecules in one close proximity. So then people thought that let us use a different technique. What is the technique? Technique is when we drink tea, often what we do is that we take a biscuit, we dip it into the tea, and then we lift the biscuit and we consume it. So eventually, if we keep on doing it, you will see after some time the tea is completely consumed. But although you have not drank the tea, you sort of eaten the tea. So similar way, people thought that we will absorb all these gases into the solid adsorbents. Fine, excellent. And the hydrogen also will be absorbed in the solid adsorbents. Absolutely fine. So this was the topic. And then there are many different solid adsorbents: activated charcoal, metal hydride, zeolites, microporous polymer, and today I'm going to discuss about the MOFs. So this was the idea. Okay, fair enough. So we will absorb the hydrogen, and once we absorb the hydrogen, we store the hydrogen, then we are going to use that. Fair enough. We discussed it. So how do we absorb or store hydrogen into a closed confinement? So apart from the solids, we can do it in 3-4 different ways. A couple of them are, one is gas cylinder. We use hydrogen cylinders in our laboratory day in, day out. They are useless. They are very cheap. They are good, but they are useless, because then you start the car, you go 10 meters and then hydrogen is gone. Then you start it again, you go and reach BT road, cylinder gone. Then you come, Dhankol, gone. Okay, like that. So it's not feasible. So we cannot keep on changing cylinders every now and then. Second objective is that you do it by liquefying hydrogen, like we do for the gas cylinder, cooking gas cylinder. But that's extremely expensive, because remember, hydrogen is the lowest element in the periodic table and very difficult to compress, right? So then the third way is the solid material or solid adsorbents. Because liquid storage is not feasible, the reason is that if you want to store something in the liquid or liquid manner, it is like this rocket fuel. There you use liquid hydrogen. Extremely expensive, because you need to do that to burn and give the thrust so that it goes to the outer space. So this was the problem, these were the challenges, and then people thought that, okay, these things are not going to work, and let us move to the solid adsorbents. So how many different choices we have? We have a few different choices. As I told you, metal hydride, carbon-based materials, complex hydrides, and MOFs, that I told you just now. Each one of them have their own drawbacks. Once again, I'm not going into it too much of detail. Let us discuss only metal hydride. Metal hydrides are extremely beautiful hydrogen storage material. They store hydrogen, they absorb hydrogen, but they don't dissolve. They don't let it go. It's like this. It's like a bank where you put your money and then you want to withdraw, nothing is coming out. Nobody wants to put those, nobody wants to use those banks. Who will? So then, there are so many different materials, so we still don't know what to use, what to do. So then Department of Energy, United States of India, they said that, okay, fair enough. Let us keep an outline, let us keep a target. For this hydrogen storage. So what is the target? The target is very simple. Target is that if you have a solid adsorbent, let's say 100 gram filled into a cylinder, you may probably ask that I have already filled the cylinder with the solid adsorbent, where the gases are going to go. Please hold on to your question. I'm going to discuss that in a minute, maybe a couple of minutes later. So if you have 100 gram of solid adsorbent inside your cylinder, then you must absorb 6 gram of hydrogen, roughly 6-8%. It's not exactly 6-8% because it becomes 106, so it should be countered. We should calculate it properly, but let's say 6 gram. Second point is the pressure cannot be more than 100 bar. Please keep it in mind that right now all the CNG vehicle, compressed natural gas that you use, that is, those cylinder pressures are 250 bar, and you can take around, I apologize, it is 200 bar, and you can absorb or store about 250 cc per cc of methane, which you use in the car. If you have seen a CNG car, you will note that these kind of values. But 200 bar pressure is a humongous pressure. I mean, there is always a chance that there could be fire or any other problem. Okay. So pressure should be 100 bar or less. Technically, pressure should be 1 bar, but of course, 1 bar is impossible to get. So, okay, 100 bar. Then the operating temperature must be minus 30 to 50 degrees centigrade. Okay, what do we mean by that? We mean that my car has to work in Alaska, and it also should work in Kolkata in summer. So it should work everywhere. Okay. If you can't say I have a car that only runs in Alaska, that's not going to work. Okay, fair enough. So keeping all this in perspective, people thought that let us make the MOF materials, and they did. They made the MOF material. Please see this beautiful crystal structure of the MOF, and these white colored dots are hydrogen adsorbed inside the MOF. So hydrogen can be absorbed inside the MOF. Okay, fantastic. How this process happens? You know, so those who are already getting bore. So I would like to show, hopefully this movie will run. Let me see, hope for the best, maybe. Yes, okay, fantastic. Okay, so if you see these MOF powders, and if you have zoomed, or if you have made a scanning electron microscopy image, SEM, you would have seen these kind of particles. This is a crystal structure. And you can see in the crystal structure, this is a real crystal structure. And you can see in the crystal structure, there are these voids. If you expose the crystal in presence of hydrogen, it will just suck it like a sponge, and it will hold it within its porous cavities. So that is the basic criteria for a MOF material. Okay, so this is exactly the way it will work. Now in reality, how it will happen, that is just a movie we made when I was a postdoc in Professor Yagi's group for the Discovery Channel and BASF. You can Google it in BASF MOF movie. You will see it is available in Google or YouTube also. Okay. So, okay, now I take the solid powder. I fill it inside this nice canister, empty canister. And my canister is filled with solid powder where the gases are going to go, where it will be absorbed. There is no space. But in reality, when we pressurize that canister, you see that it can take, in this particular case, this is for the methane, it can take round about almost 3 to 4 times of methane compared to the empty canister. These are the empty canister, these are the empty ones, and this is the filled canister with the solid powder. So it can absorb hydrogen, okay? And these powders can absorb hydrogen, although it was looking like that, you know, the solid powders have absorbed all the space, I mean, occupied all the space, and there is no space for hydrogen storage. Then how are they doing it? Let us see. Okay. So this is the empty canister. And there is, as you can see, all the gas molecules are absorbed on the surface. Please make a note that this is only gas molecule. You are not giving too much pressure here, because the pressure we are already stuck. We cannot go beyond 100 bar. So, okay. So in the wall, because of the Brownian motion, these hydrogen molecules are interacting with the wall surface. Then if you want to cut down the wall, you don't want to use the empty space which you have here. This empty space you want to cut down, you want to prolong. So you don't want to have so much empty space. You want to have more surface area. So you have prolonged this this wall. You have made spikes all over the place. And then these are all hydrogen molecules are absorbed on the spike. Okay. And if you take out these hydrogen molecules and you flatten it into a piece of paper, one by one, they occupy, once again, let's think, let's say 1 meter by 1 meter space. So in a flat sheet, it occupies 1 meter by 1 meter space, which is nothing but 1 meter square. Okay, theek. Then let us say we kill all the void space inside the cylinder, we put a lot of sand. Okay, we put a lot of sand, fantastic. Once we put a lot of sand, it is not only getting absorbed on the inner surface or the inner surface of the wall or the cylinder, but also on the surface of the sand. Okay, so we have added sand. So once we have added sand, now it is covered the inner surface of the sand, and then we have absorbed more amount, you know, much more amount of, let's say, hydrogen or any other gas. If we flatten it again, let's say for 1 gram of sand sample, we get, let's say, 10 by 10, like 100 meter square surface area. This is called 100 meter square per gram surface area. This is the surface. Okay. Similarly, now when the MOF molecule comes into the picture, not only on the outer surface it will absorb, but now it will absorb in the inner surface as well. Because remember the void, remember the pores, it will do that. And now you will get 100 into 100, which is 10,000 meter square per gram of the MOF material surface. And that's the beauty of it. And that's why people are really looking into these materials. So this is the way you measure the surface area using nitrogen adsorption isotherm. I'm not going into too much of detail today because of the lack of time. But what I want to emphasize is that why people started working on it, why people became so interested and, you know, intrigued by this material. Because as I told you that if you compare to the traditional ones, the zeolite, silica and carbon, these materials do have a beauty that you can design this material into the laboratory, number one, and you can go to the laboratory and make this material. Okay. So that's the beauty of it. And you can make it the way you want to make it. And not only that, right now we discussed about the terephthalic acid. You may say that, you know, I don't want to handle acid. I don't care about acid. So, okay, you can make MOF materials with some imidazoles also. Look at this imidazole. You know, simple imidazole reacted with metal. It forms metal imidazolate. And this metal imidazolate structures have a nice bent angle that gives a different kind of flavor on this MOF material. So you can see this is the metal is coordinated with the imidazole and it forms this nice architecture. Not only that, as I told you, you think about it into the laboratory, and once you think about it that I want to make a particular metal imidazolate, I want to change the imidazole or I want to change the metal, whatever, and you think, you design it in your laboratory in a piece of paper and you go to the laboratory and make them. That's the way you do it. And I'll show you, you know, how many different varieties you can make. You can see this is the porous architecture. This is the yellow ball, which represents the open framework. So this beautiful structure, you can see how many varieties you can make. I'll show you. Just take a look, watch over these images. Just, you don't have to even really pay too much attention. Just watch over like a movie and you'll see. So, okay, you can see now this one. Then you can make a cobalt, okay, that didn't change the overall structure. Metal. Now you see another different variety. It's completely different architecture changed. Now you see this is another one. And you can keep on taking all different varieties and different types of metal organic frameworks. You can make, not only that, you can make a large structure, you can make a small structure, you can make a large pore, you can make small pore. I mean absolutely different ways to make this material and the way you want to do it. And that is the beauty of the material, I think, and I go to the lab and I make it. Okay, now coming back to it. Now, these are all beautiful things I told. Let us come back to the reality. MOF materials can actually achieve all these targets, maybe a little bit less cost or more cost. I'm not 100% sure, but most of the targets it can take care. What it can't do is that it cannot work. It can only work at 77 Kelvin. It can only work at 77 Kelvin. That's it. That is a big problem. Now, 77 Kelvin is minus 200 degree centigrade temperature, roughly. Okay, roughly. I mean, that is really not a feasible. You cannot run a car at minus 200 degree centigrade temperature. And those who are watching this presentation, I want to tell you that I have been working on this field for almost 10 years now, if not more. And I have been trying to make these and that and whatnot and whatever. And I couldn't do it. And so far, I couldn't solve the problem. But I believe some of you in future, you know, will be able to do this job. So with this, I want to switch gear and come to the second part, which is the CO2. I don't want to spend too much time, but I want to say a simple things about, you know, this global warming and whatnot. You know, all of us are telling, you know, Gadi Dhoa and whatever. So what is the problem of the CO2? The problem of the CO2, I'll tell you a very simple thing, you know. So I visited Tata Steel and they have said that they have a big concern of CO2. So I said, everybody has a concern. They said, no, not that concern. Concern is, see, they want to run the blast furnace. any furnace or any, let's say, unun or chula, if you have to run, you have to purge oxygen, right? We used to blow oxygen when my grandmother used to, you know, light up a chula in the afternoon, smoke everywhere, we can't breathe, whatnot, you know, and then the smoke will disappear, the chula will start burning. So you need to give oxygen. Now, how do they give oxygen? They just extract oxygen from the atmosphere. That's fine. They just pump air. Okay. But they need to dry the air. They cannot put purge moist air. You know, we are sweating like anything and this moist air is not going to work. Mm-hmm. Okay. How do they purify it? How do they remove the moisture? They run it through calcium oxide beds. Calcium oxide absorbs the moisture, becomes calcium hydroxide, and so on. So they why calcium oxide? Because it is cheapest. Why cheapest? Because we make it from calcium carbonate, like chalk. So calcium carbonate, you make calcium oxide, but everything is, you know, something else will also come with it, calcium oxide plus carbon dioxide. So that is the calcium carbonate structure, CaCO3, right? So CO3 means CaO plus CO2. So calcium carbonate, there is the problem. Okay, all right. Now that is the big issue. So in order to make calcium oxide, you need to sacrifice carbon dioxide. So you need to purge this carbon dioxide out in the atmosphere. And that's when all the greenhouse gas problems happen. You know, afternoon in the winter time, we can't see each other. It is so foggy and smog and whatnot, and all kinds of problems. Believe me, we can't blame the industry. Industries know this problem. They know it very well. And they try to also ratify the problem because nobody wants to breathe in a polluted, and nobody wants to stay in a polluted environment. So what they do is they run this carbon dioxide through the amine scrubbers. Why amine? Because amine is basic, carbon dioxide acidic, acid plus base reaction. We have studied in class 10 or class 5 or whatever, they form salt, they precipitate. Okay. So like that, they absorb the CO2, extremely expensive process, not at all chemically viable, not at all industrially viable, but they still use it. They spend a lot of money. They don't spend. This comes from you and me. So what the Tata people told that, can you design a framework material which will help us to extract that CO2, whatever you are throwing into the atmosphere, and store it into a container? I said, why do you want to store it into a container? Very simple, because we want to sell it. I said, CO2 sell to whom? He said, beverage industries, Fanta, Mirinda, Coke, Pepsi, plus soda water, you know, we use it for some other purpose. This lockdown state, it is not very easy to get. So anyway, so these materials, and this CO2, from where it's coming? So they are selling this CO2. So they said that, okay, if you put a metal organic framework in the cylinders, and if it can do like, you know, 14, 15 cylinders, we'll make a lot of savings in transport. Transport savings means profit. Think always from a scientist. As a scientist, we always think from an industry perspective a little bit. Not that I'm asking everybody to do it, but let us think from that perspective. At least we can think. I mean, you know, sochne mein kya hai? I mean, we are not spending money. Na? So what we decided that, theek hai, okay, so we designed one metal organic framework with this amine functionalities inside, and we did some testing, and we found out that these amine scrubbers, exactly like this, you know, amine molecule, they trap the CO2. This is the CO2 molecule. This is the crystal structure. And you can see this inside the MOF material, they really trap and isolate this CO2 molecule. So that was very interesting. Anyway, so this was the whole idea behind this. It is still going on in my laboratory. Now I want to finish my presentation in next about 5 to 10 minutes, or maybe probably less, by saying one particular material that we are working currently. This material, as I have told you, that this metal organic framework, or I discussed about this zeolites a little bit, I discussed about metal organic frameworks, porous carbon, and so on. So the problem with this material, the metal organic framework, and whatever we are saying, that beautiful this, beautiful that, they have a serious problem that they are not stable in water. They hydrolyze in water. They go bad in water. So then when we started the research in our laboratory and some other people all over the world, we were thinking that let us ditch the metal. Let us forget about the metal. Let us make a metal organic framework or an organic framework, crystalline, which is where there is no metal. Okay, fantastic. So we didn't invent it. Omar Yagi group initially invented, and they decided that we can, if we take boronic acid, you can make this nice joint kind of thing. You can see this particular joint. And if you take diboronic acid, you can also make this nice architecture, joint to joint, joint to joint, exactly like the graphitic structure. And these structures have nice porosity, they are crystalline. So they figured it out. And they gave, once again, very simple name, because they are covalent in nature, they are organic in nature, and to their framework, so covalent organic framework. So when we came into the picture, what we figured out that, you know, it's not that easy to make this material. Why? Because if you want to take an organic linker and you want to react with another organic linker, you have to do covalent bond formation. Very simple. And otherwise, you cannot make an organic polymer. You know, none of these materials, you know, our shirt and all these things that you are using, organic material, everywhere there is a covalent bond. So you have to form a covalent bond. And you want to form the covalent bond in this particular way so that they organize in a very periodic manner. And they form this nice stacked layer where these nice pores exist. So this is the covalent organic framework we are talking about. So this we should make. If we can make, this will show a very nice porosity and crystalline material. So this is our idea. This we should be able to make covalent bond formation. Well, you can make it. There are many different ways you can make it. So one of the way is this boraxene ring. As you can see, every time you use this covalent bond formation, you can make this covalent organic framework using simple organic reaction. Very simple organic reaction. You cannot get into a complicated one. But please make a note, there is some water issues are there. So you have to take the water out and so that it follows the Lachatelier's principle and forms the product. Excuse me, it has to be reversible in nature as well. Because why? Because remember, unless it is reversible in nature, it won't crystallize, because crystallization is a slow process. Crystallization is entropically a not favorable process. You know, it should not happen if it is entropy is only in the perspective, because delta G equals to delta H minus T delta S. So in this particular case, entropy is negative. So delta G is positive, which is not correct. So it is entropically disfavorable process. Fair enough. Keep it that in mind. So that's why you have to give it time, so that delta H is more negative, so that the reaction is going in the forward direction or the crystallization happens. So that is when another issue comes into the picture. What is, if something can go in forward direction and it is reversible, then it can come in backward direction as well. That's absolutely correct. Yes, it can. And that is when, if you make a covalent organic framework, you expose it to water, you need a little bit of water to make it, but you expose it into water, it's gone, completely dead, decomposed. So I wanted to make a stable material, and I removed all the metals, and then I made a material, I crystallized it, I put so much effort, and then eventually that material is even more unstable. So I am back to square one. So what we did, this I will not go to get into the too much technical detail. We did a little bit of chemical modification into the system so that the crystallinity remains intact and it also becomes chemically stable. Once again, I do not wish to go into too much of detail over here, and I will refrain from doing it. But what I want to show is that after we made the material, we need to have a material which is porous, crystalline, and chemically stable. All this has to be there, otherwise it will not work. So we figured out that, okay, once we synthesize this material, we were worried about the crystallinity, but we found out that they are very crystalline, so we know the structure. Then second is porous, they are very porous. You know, these blue dots represent the nitrogen adsorption isotherm. As you can see, in the zero pressure, the absorption is very nice, and then it's flattened out, you know, at a particular pressure. So when there is no pressure or absolute low pressure, it is keep on absorbing because of the interaction, and these materials behave very nice porous features. Okay, but that being said, you know, if you treat these materials in water and put it into boiling water for a longer period of time, then still they are very stable, and that's where, you know, this chemical stability kept into the picture. Similarly, you put it into the acid, they are very stable, and so on and so forth. So all these are very nicely done, what we felt. Not only that, if you put it into sodium hydroxide, think about it, in 9 normal sodium hydroxide, you dip your hand in, let's say, 1 normal sodium hydroxide, and you'll see your hand is full of swells. You know, that is such a corrosive material. Don't do that at home or anywhere in the laboratory. Always measure tremendous caution. But sodium hydroxide is extremely corrosive material. So if that is the case, these materials are even stable in sodium hydroxide. I mean, you can imagine how beautiful these materials are. But then while synthesizing it, we figured that, as I told you, that I want to make this material in this particular way, very nicely ordered. Please understand, they are not school children. You know, they are organic molecules. So you want them to become like this, they will eventually become that. They will form the kinetic product. They will never form the thermodynamic product. And they will have a haphazard reaction. And you will get a precipitate, very nice yellow precipitate or whatever. That is good for nothing, complete junk. So this kinetic product will prevail. So in order to have a thermodynamic product and kill the kinetic product off, we use this freeze pump thaw cycle, which is a brutal technique, absolutely not worthy for the lab, because it takes about 7-8 days. It needs any atmosphere, it needs toxic solvents, it will only give you a yield in milligram scale, absolutely unworthy. You don't want to do that. But we were doing it. We were publishing papers, this, that. And then eventually, I went to Tata Industries. And they told that, these porous materials, they are so good. We heard about you and this, that. Can you solve one simple problem for us? I said, yes, I can do everything, And they showed me this pipe. And they said that CO2 is coming through this pipe. You can see the pipe. Those who are thinking that I am faking it, please see the size of the truck. And this is the pipe. So they said, can you fill covalent organic framework so that it will take out all the CO2? And I was thinking, our children, our students' children, their children, we will keep on making covalent organic framework. This pipe will never fill, in this process that I have just told. So we have to figure out a way so that we can fast and quickly synthesize this material in bulk. How? We want to make it fast, this particular process, but as soon as I am trying to make it fast, I am always getting this junk. So how do I take care of it? So that time we kept on trying. And we thought that, we are making a fundamental mistake. We are allowing this to react very quickly. We are allowing this to react very quickly. So that's not a very, very good thing. It's like this, we have a age for marriage. Like for the girls, it is 18, and for the boys, it is 21, right? So child marriage is not allowed. Why? Because there are biological issues regarding to that. So similarly, for a chemical bond formation or a particular product to form, you must have a particular recipe or particular timeline. So in this case, the reaction is happening too fast, too early. And that's why we are getting this garbage. Okay. So how do I slow down the reaction? We can do a complete slowdown. Like, for example, you can forget about the marriage and then we will be all extinct. At some point, we are all going to die and there will be no children in the earth, and then the human population will extinct. But that's not going to work. So it cannot be completely stopped, right? So it has to be slowed down, the process, so that there is always, we get a final product, we have enough number of people so that we can feed them and so on and so forth, right? So we slow down the process how? So we thought that instead of directly doing this reaction, amine to aldehyde reaction, let us try to make a salt. Amine is basic. I react with organic acid plus base, once again, salt. And I do the reaction of that salt with the aldehyde. Why? Because salt, in that case, this nitrogen is protonated. It is not free. So in order to, aldehyde cannot react with protonated nitrogen. It's not very difficult to deprotonate, but it takes a little bit of time. So that will be my time. So I take an acid, I form a salt, lots of hydrogen bonding. The aldehyde is coming into the picture. It needs to break the hydrogen bonding, which takes a little bit of more time. And that time in the molecular level, not in the general level. And then that time gives us this nice product where the aldehyde can react, the delay, and finally crystallize. So we slow down the process in such a way so that we get this fine product at the end at our hand. So this is the way. Think about this reaction a little bit. Think how we make pottery. We take the clay, we add some stuff, ingredients, and then we give it nice shape, and we put it into the furnace, and then we make the pot. That's the way we have been doing. Exactly same process we did. We took organic salt, So same pottery. I mean, eventually, if you ask me what have you done so far in your career, I said that, those pottery people, whatever they could do, you know, in maybe 1 month, it took me some 10 years to figure out that process. Anyway, so we took the organic acid and we react with amine. We make this nice paste, like exactly like we make our dough, bread, and then we make the dough and then we flatten it and then we put it into tawa and then we make this nice chapati out of it. So same thing we are doing. So we are making this acid plus amine forms a nice salt. Add the aldehyde, a tiny amount of water. Remember, in the bread also, you add slowly, you add water and you mix it, right? And you make the dough. So same thing. And then you heat it up at 170 degrees centigrade temperature, bake it. That's it. You have made your porous material exactly like you have used. You do it in your house, those who are making biscuits and cake and bread in the oven. So same process, exactly same process that we have been doing. And we got a very beautiful powder diffraction data. So showing that they are very crystalline in nature, which I was very proud of. Not only that, the surface area now became, previously this using this freeze pump thaw, we were getting about 100, 1000, 2000 something. Now we started getting 3000, 3500. So this slight change in the process gave us a nice and beautiful crystalline material. And as a result, the surface area increased. Okay, so that's pretty much it is what I wanted to discuss. But as you will of course ask that, okay, so you went to Tata Steel, you wanted to fill their pipe and whatnot. What happened to that? Yeah, of course, I didn't forget that. So we, you know, now standardized the process. We made this like this semi making caster we used and make these nice beads and all. And after that, we figured out that in Vishnupur and all, they are doing this nice terracotta temple and they are using this very simple technique. Terracotta means baked earth. Baked earth, it's an Italian word, terracotta. So it means baked earth, and these beautiful temples in Vishnupur and other places in West Bengal is made of the terracotta and they are stable for quite some time. And I thought that, wow, so that should be the trick. And we did that exactly. We made use this terracotta process into our material and we could make this nice lamp and beer, I mean, this bhalu and stuff like that. And we could make this in bulk material using a simple twin screw extruder. What is a twin screw extruder? Those who don't know what is a twin screw extruder, just think about our masala making. So how do you grind it? Same thing, exactly same thing. So you have two screws going in clockwise and anti-clockwise direction. So there is a friction and you add your ingredient in between and you get the product, period. That's twin screw extruder, okay? So we have been making this material in bulk and we have been testing their stability study, you can see, and working with other companies. Let's see how far we can go. It's still a long way to go. And they are very nicely porous, crystalline. I have already showed you, chemically stable though also. Okay, so that's pretty much what I wanted to discuss, and I hope you understood something, at least few things. If you are facing difficulties, then I will be happy to discuss those parts. And but I think overall, as you can see, with these new ideas, you can not only do organic chemistry, but also you can do physical materials chemistry, electrochemistry, recognition, and catalysis, and many other things. If you just do a little bit of permutation combination and make this new beautiful material for yourself, those who are planning to do research on the material science. What are the other things it can do? Okay, a lot. I told you about the hydrogen storage, CO2 capture a little bit. It can do methane storage, sensor, sequestration, catalysis, drug delivery, and whatnot. And recently, people are trying to take these metal organic frameworks. They are changing metals to calcium rather than zinc or copper and using amino acids and making these nice metal amino acid complexes, which they believe that could be used for osteoporosis. And these are edible type of material. Finally, I'd like to thank all of you. You know, you are here. I mean, you have, I hope you have, I didn't bore you too much. And I would like to acknowledge my students, all the funding agencies, and all my collaborators. And I have a smaller lab now at ICER Kolkata. And finally, I thank all of you for your patience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Banerjee. Thank you, sir. And on behalf of organizing committee, once again I want to thank you for your insightful deliberation, your lecture on the new domain of metal organic framework for the 21st century in our virtual platform is very interesting. informative and inspiring. Thanks for an excellent presentation, sir. Thank you very much. And one thing, sir, in your initial remark, you talked about the merit and demerit about this presentation in virtual form in the physically. So I hope we have a little consent from you in near future when the everything is cooled down. Then I looking for your positive response physically in our institution.
Yes, I already told that, you know, I would have loved to come here, but unfortunately now due to lockdown and whatnot, yes, we are all stuck at our home. That is pretty boring, you know, honestly speaking.
No, sir, it was very interesting. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, couple of minutes, if there is any questions from participants, please don't unmute your but just you can write your questions in chat box. Your participants,
if yeah, you have chat any box, you know, if they want, they can also verbally ask.
Yes, as per you can also verbally ask the question. Anybody else?
I have a question. I mean, this is Ramendra from INST Mohali.
Yes,
indeed, it's a very good lecture. So I have a small question. For example, they have shown CO2 storage using metal organic framework. So have you thought for, I mean, it can be storage as well as in the further step, it can reduce to fuel. I mean, one MOF can purpose both the problem. Have you thought for it?
Yes, if you're talking about CO2 to fuel, there are a couple of ways to look into it. One is CO2 to, let's look into a broader sense, CO2 to value added products.
Right.
So yeah, so CO2 to value added product means what? So you can make CO2 to methane, you can make CO2 to methanol, and you can also make CO2 to, let's say, polycarbonate. So polycarbonate is not a directly a fuel, but methane and methanol is. So question is, if we want to make CO2 to methane and CO2 to methanol, you need hydrogen. So you need to reduce CO2. I mean, otherwise, how will you do that?
Yeah.
So first, second thing is that your energy, also you have to keep it in mind that during the process of making, you should not generate more methane.
Yeah.
So there has to be an economy. No. So in order to make a fuel, I should not burn more fuel. So that will not help. So that is where people are now trying to look into it, and that's where people are trying to do this kind of CO2 to methane or CO2 to methanol process using photocatalysis, not only using metal organic framework, but lots of other materials using Maxine, graphene, and other things. And everywhere people are, I mean, every material has its own merits, demerits, whatever it is. But yes, if you ask me about the CO2 storage, now today I would say that storing CO2 does not mean much. I haven't had an opportunity to discuss about these catalytic processes, but it should be CO2 to some value-added product. It's very challenging because I discussed about the polycarbonate somewhere, and someone asked, okay, you make CO2 to polycarbonate. What I'm supposed to do with that? Who will purchase? What do you do with the polycarbonate? So all these are tricky things in an industrial scale. If we think it is, these are really, really tricky things. But this is where CO2 to value-added product is a currently a hot research. I mean, a lot of people are working all over the world. Once again, so many different, you know, nitty-gritties. And I personally believe that one person will not be able to solve this problem. It has to be a group of people to solve this. And yes, your question is very valid that we must look into it. And this MOX material has been, we have used these materials, and others have also done it to make CO2 to value added.
Yeah, true. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody is there for asking question? So I think there is no question in chat box also. So once again, thank you, Professor Banerjee, for your kind commitment and sparing your valuable time with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you all. for your valuable time, and thank you for your patience. And with your permission, I shall disconnect now. Thank you so very much, Dr. Kunal, and thanks to all the other organizers for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
I welcome you here. I think the few resource person is here. Welcome, Professor Arote. Welcome, Dr. Devistri Khan also. Dr. Sukhdev Pal also here. So I welcome you all in this for joining with us. So the first session is actually over. The one thing I would like to convey our participants that the registration and following and filling up the feedback does not provide the certificate of this, but as indicated in our brochure, so a adequate time of presence in the virtual mode is entitled for receiving the certificate. So this is very important. We will resume once again in the technical session 2 at 7:00. After, so we come back in the technical session 2 at around 2 p.m. and the first lecture was Dr. Ramendra Sundar Day. So thank you very much all the participants and our resource persons also for your attention and patience. Thank you very much.